What we wrote 225 years ago still mean that these are the rules? This is what assured that the people remain free.
This Thursday, the godfather of libertarianism, John Stossel, joins the founding fathers on his program to ask, does anyone still care about the Constitution? From freedom of the press to gun rights, Stossel explores our most cherished legal document. He also wears a powdered wig. He rocks it. John Stossel is back with us. So
I still care.
See, some people have a paper copy of the Constitution in their office, but you actually have a scroll.
This is the real one, real Constitution. But hey, I'm nobody's godfather. Godfather of libertarianism.
James Brown of libertarianism.
Milton Friedman, Murray Rothbard.
Ludwig von Mises, John Stossel. That's
well, I don't know that Mises called himself a libertarian, did he?
No. He called himself Alex. That's not true.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. I believe what you say.
I know you do, and that's why I adore you. So tell me about the show. What did you find in your quest?
We became this odd country where we kept democracy. We became prosperous. We were a poor country when this thing was written. And Ben Franklin said, if you can keep it for 225 years, now we've kept it, and it's worked. And what it says, of course, is that the powers that the federal government has are limited. That left people free enough to do all those good things. But now they just act like they can do whatever they want.
Yeah, and people worry that if the federal government is too limited, the people will do really bad things.
How limited can it be? It's spending almost $3 trillion. It regulates everything. 22 million people work for federal, state, and local governments. I mean, how can they even talk about it being too limited?
What parts of the Constitution are being most rigorously violated, in your view? What's the weak point?
Hard to pick, but a big one is that Congress is supposed to declare war. Yeah. James Madison said, you know, that's the most important thing. Leave this in the power of the legislature. And even President Obama, as a candidate, said the president does not have the power to authorize an attack if it does not involve stopping an actual or imminent threat to the nation.
I mean, that's in the War Powers Act. You know, and the Constitution is very clear on this. And, you know, the law, as it was written in the 70s, says basically the opposite of what the president is doing. Someone who claimed to be a constitutional scholar, but, you know, has the
Once
same
elected,
for a number
they taste
of
the power and everything changes.
Okay, let me ask you this. If someone like Rand Paul is elected, who is a more libertarian Republican, do you think that he'll taste the power and lose his mind?
Well, I've learned not to fall in love with politicians, but I don't think so. I think he gets it and would be better.
Well, John, what do you think about the average American's appreciation or understanding of what the Constitution is and what it's for? Oftentimes I hear people talking about democracy, 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 as though that is the standard. But the quote is, it's you have a republic if you can keep it, that it's limited by something, namely the Constitution. You think most people get that?
No. And a lot of people say, why should this apply now? These guys owned slaves. They wore those stupid outfits.
It's true.
Just doing this shtick for this show is ridiculous.
They're going to look at us in 200 years and be like, what were they wearing around their necks?
That'll be for you.
Well, not me. Not me. This is timeless. Classic.
It's so timeless. James Madison would have loved that smooth tie.
That and the white wig thing. I'm going to try that.
Just one remarkable thing. 14 times the Supreme Court, with Obama appointees, has voted 9-0 against things the administration's done. Mm-hmm. That should send a message.
Yeah, and some of those are core First Amendment things that no administration should be on the wrong side of. Our social conservative friends, I don't consider myself a social conservative, they frequently make an argument with their libertarian friends that we need to nourish a culture of liberty or else your precious libertarian rights won't be respected. Are they right about that? I kind of suspect that they are, that we need to nourish something that allows for more respect for this document and the principles behind it. Otherwise, we're going to have a bunch of lefties talking about, yeah, due process, schmoo process, everyone's a rapist, you know, let's bring them up.
Well, yes, nourish a culture. And I also agree with them that we should nourish a culture that discourages abortion and discourages people from taking drugs or doing abusive things to themselves. But there's a big difference between nourishing a culture and force. And the founders worried about government because government is force, and they'd experienced nasty force in Europe.
Yeah.
It's important that liberals and social conservatives and libertarians remember, God, there's a big difference between voluntary and force. Voluntary is better. Oh, I'm all for nourishing cultures.
Yes, and it doesn't mean that you encourage those things. Now, with your experience in broadcasting and liberty and in putting the show together, what do you think, if people have their druthers, which amendment would they get rid of?
You need to give me time to think about questions like that. I don't know. They'd get rid of a lot of them. I mean, all my neighbors could get rid of the Second Amendment.
Yeah, wait till they, who are they going to come running to when it goes down?
The police will protect us, yeah. They'll say.
In 20 minutes
the police can go
so.
Back to their homes and their families. You know, the good ones will stay. But they're going to run to the man with the gun and the supplies and the water and the mustache. John Stossel, thank you so much.
I'm hoarding all those.
Yes, he is. And that is why we adore him endlessly. Don't forget, you